Hey guys, it's Agnes Dunmore again, and welcome back to my channel. So first of all, thank you again for joining today. I really appreciate your time. I also wanted to ask you, if you haven't subscribed yet, please do so by just clicking on the button below and hitting subscribe, because it's really gonna help me in bringing you a lot more content. Today I'm really excited. Because I actually was able to capture the information from the Oculus controller and send it to my TCP server. So some of you know that I've been working on a VR draw experience, and my goal for that experience is to be able to have other people join me. So what I accomplished was I'm actually able to draw, and every point that I'm drawing is captured and sent to the TCP server. TCP server gets the information and is sending back to the client. So that's what I wanna show you. I actually was able to get it working on the Oculus Quest, and I was able to get it working with few changes that I had to do in the manifest. So let's jump into Unity and I started looking at it. Alright guys, so let me show you what I have so far, and the introduction was to kind of give you an idea of what I have going on. So now I can run it on the device. I'm sending points and lines to the TCP server, so I'm pretty happy with the results. As you can see, I'm sending a lot of data across, and a lot of it is just an XYZ component and also a line component that I've been sending. So I want to show you some of the things that I have to change in order for this to work, and some of the data structure changes as well. So the first thing that I also needed to do, because it wasn't running on the device, is I needed to modify the permissions on the manifest. So I ended up modifying the permissions on both of the manifests. So if you look in here, I have two different user permissions now. One is access to the internet, and then one access to the network state. Those are the two that I read that Oculus requires anytime that you're accessing the local area network. And in my case, I have my server running on my box, so I needed to access the network state. The other one, I also changed it. I didn't know if I needed to change both, but this one is for the store, and then I believe this one is just for the one that were running during development. So I changed it on both just to be safe. So the next thing that I changed as well was, not only I incremented the size of these, but I also made some changes on the font. So I made it much smaller because I wanted to see more data, and I also made it a lot bigger, and then I ended up moving everything to the right side. So the other thing that I can also do now is I can run this by specifying an IP address and a port, because I know that this is going to be changing, and I didn't want to just use the loopback address, which is the 127 address. So instead, I updated the server to accept that as an argument. So let me show you that right now so that you can see what I changed in the server. So, and I'm going to let's go ahead and jump into the server here. So the only thing that I'm doing now is I'm saying, okay, if the argument's length is less than 2, meaning that the person who is initiating the server didn't specify more than, or at least two arguments, then I'm gonna throw a message, and then I'm not gonna let him start the server. So for instance, if I were to do something like this, if I do just the IP address and not the server, I'm gonna get that specified server and port, not post. So let me just change that and then do that one more time. So specify server and port, and then you can see the example here. And then if I do just .NET run and not specifying any of the two parameters, I'm also going to get that error. I could also change this to run on a different port if I wanted to run on 8080. I can run it 8080, and I also see a new nice message telling the person who initiated the server where the server is running from. So I'm also doing that right here. It says server started, and then I'm also printing the message saying listening on this, basically on that IP address and then that port. And then I'm also passing the IP address here and also the port number as an integer. That's what I'm converting it in here. I know I need to do some more validation, but I think for right now, this works great. And I'm going to be checking this in as well to the repository where I have my TCP server. So now that I show you that piece, if we go back in here, let's run on 8080. I think 8080 is fine. And then I'm going to go into Unity. The other cool thing is I can also run these on the editor, and I don't have to wait and do it on the device. So if we're going to change this to 8080, and then we go ahead and hit play, you're going to see that we're going to get a connection, and which is the same thing that I was getting before. So, but the other cool thing is I can also draw and then see the changes. So this is the first thing that I was testing before, right after I finished the previous video. So the other thing that I can do here is if I want to draw, you can see that I'm sending, you know, I'm sending points, I'm drawing, and then this is also getting the list of points in the line. So where do we go from here? I can show you a couple of things that I change, and then I really wanna get to a point where I am sending points and I'm also getting points from a client. Unfortunately, I only have one Oculus Quest, but I think I can make it, I can create more of like a, it's not gonna be full AI, but it's going to be basically a mock-up client that it's gonna be sending and drawing around. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna mock a client that is gonna be drawing around and it's gonna do curves. And then we can kind of get an idea of how that's gonna look like when somebody else joins. But for now, I'm just gonna keep it like this. And then I'll have that ready for the next video so you can see what I'm doing. And then at some point I'll get another Oculus and then maybe have my wife or some of my friends, you know, try with me and I can do a video with two people or more. All right, so now that I have this running, I show you most of the stuff that I added in here, but I wanna show you the code and how I'm getting the client information over to the server. So the other thing that I had to do here is I also needed to change, let me go back to the other code. This is the code for the client. So I had to add a couple of more things. So I needed to add, because the way that I'm implementing the line render, I have two different methods. I have one method that I have when I'm updating the line, which is this one right here. So if I'm updating a line, I'm only doing an update on the line, meaning that I'm passing a vector 3 with a position. Then I'm also checking, okay, have I added that line to the list of lines? If I haven't, I create a new line, and then I add the point that I'm passing into that existing line. So this is gonna happen as I draw a line, and then as soon as I add a new line, this is the method that's gonna get called, and then I'm gonna basically add the line, because this one right here is the point, so I'm adding points. But if I need to add a new line, I'm going to add the active line to the list of lines. And then I'll create a new line for the brand new line that we're going to be drawing. And then I add that to the list of, basically to the list of points. And I'm realizing here, I think I have, let me check. Oh, yeah. This is how it works. So I'm creating a new line, and then I'm adding the new point on the new line to the list of points. I was getting a little confused there. So you might realize that I changed this a little bit. I have what's called an active line, and I also have my draw payload. This didn't change, but this did change. I needed to specify multiple lines. So the reason for that is because if we go here, let's go and look at our payload. So now the payload is gonna be a list of draw lines. And then the draw line component, it's going to have, not a component, the class, is going to have a list of draw points. So imagine a line having multiple points, and then we can have multiple lines in a drawing. So when you start drawing and you basically let go of the trigger button on the Oculus, that means that you stop drawing that line. If you start a new line, that's going to create a new line. So that's why I did it this way. Now I have a draw payload that can have many lines, and then inside of it, I can have a draw line that has many points. So if we go into the point, you can see that I also have, you know, or X, Y, and Z. The other thing that I needed to change is because we're dealing with very small numbers and we need to do floats, not integers. And I did that on the previous video. I was using integers. So I changed this to be floats. And it just basically gives us a lot of more flexibility when it comes to that. And also the vector 3, x, y, and z, it's a float. So that's why I ended up changing. I realized that I had the run, basically the run type. And you can see that the x is a float, y is a float, and also z is a float. The other thing that I also did is I make this a singleton because I'm only going to have one client in this instance that is going to be myself. And then what I'm going to do is I might inherit from this. And the reason why I'm going to do that is because I'm going to have other people that are playing against me, so, or are drawing against me. And I shouldn't say against because they're not really fighting with me. They're going to be drawing with me. So, but I'm going to be inheriting these to be more of a, it's going to be my peer, the person that is drawing with me. So I will have another object that represents that. And then those are going to be creating dynamically as, you know, somebody joins the experience. I'm going to be creating a new TCP client for them so that we can get information for them as well. So that's honestly everything that I wanted to show you guys. If you guys have any questions about what I just showed you, please let me know in the comments. And then, you know, if you like what you see, let me know in the comments, because it's always cool to know that you guys are, you know, are enjoying the content that I'm creating. So thank you very much, guys. All right, guys, thank you much for watching this video. I really appreciate your time. And if you have any questions about what I just showed you, please let me know in the comments. Also, be sure to check out gamedev.net because they have amazing resources for game developers. And also find me in patreon.com where I'm posting information about what I'm doing behind the scenes and also early access source code. Thank you very much, guys.